Gabrielle is going to lead us in a reflection beginning June 15. Gabrielle is going to be working in the staff of the parish as adult faith formation coordinator. And Sister Bernadette, who's now in Steubenville, she also will be joining in August the staff, and she will be doing the prayer and worship team coordinator. So it's good for you to know we have been, since Barb left, without head in something, so little by little we are going to try to have clear head in all the ministries of the parish. Without more words, I will let Gabrielle lead us now.
Father mentioned I'm Gabrielle, and he asked me to give a short reflection on the fruits of Holy Communion. Can you hear me well in the back? Okay. About 10 years ago, I was able to teach a CCD class, a religious ed class here at St. Mary's, and I was lucky enough to be assigned to second grade, which was helping the kids learn about First Communion, I guess. And third and fourth and so on. But I was so excited to be able to teach these little kiddos. I wanted to give them this joy to receive Jesus. I wanted them to really know who was in the Eucharist. And so, of course, you know, you have to kind of catch them in the moments where they're paying attention. So I spent all year trying to get them to grasp a very large concept. And I was so proud of them and thought they really were ready for First Holy Communion. So, of course, in May, I'm sitting there in the front pew with them all. They're all dressed up in their white gowns and their little bow ties. And, you know, it comes to the moment of consecration, and I'm so excited for them to really be present and see Jesus consecrated. Because, you know, all this time, a lot of the times maybe they haven't been really paying attention. So all of a sudden I'm like really praying for these kids and excited for them to experience this moment. And the little boy next to me, I noticed he's like slumping over in his seat, and I was like, what is he doing at this moment? I was trying to figure it out. And he's kind of like wriggling around, just kind of shifting and wriggling, and then I hear him whispering to himself, "I am a slug." And he is acting out being a slug right then in the pew. Telling the moment of consecration, this is what he's thinking about. What if I was a giant slug? And all of a sudden, this, you know, 9 months of pouring my life into this class, I was like, oh no! Like, stop, Father, wait, I have to explain again. The Spirit is not getting it. And this is like the great leap of faith, right? You give this child Holy Communion and you trust that someday he's really gonna realize it's Jesus and have his mind in the right place. But I always laugh at this story. I love this story because really, I think how many times in the moment of consecration, I usually don't think I'm a giant slug ever, I don't think. But I do let my mind drift away and think of all sorts of other things that really are in the same ballpark as, you know, pretending I'm a slug. And so I think it always behooves us to take a moment and reflect on the fruits of Holy Communion because really, all of us, we forget it. It just slips our mind and we start to get accustomed to what it is we're receiving. One more quick story. I love to tell stories, so we'll see if we ever get to any fruits. But also about 10 years ago, a little before I came back to Corvallis, I was volunteering in Belize in Central America. And there I had the experience of working with a really dynamic group of young Catholics. There's also a group of seminarians from the United States working in this village. And one of them told me about this young woman named Danielle Rose. I don't even remember her last name, but she had a video that she had made of herself. So he gave it to me to watch. So I'm sitting. You think this is hot. In Belize, it's like 100 degrees, 100% humidity. So I'm sitting there sweating profusely and watching this video on my little laptop. Danielle Rose was a young woman who had a gift for music, and she would record CDs of these songs she would write, adoring God or speaking about her experience of faith. And then she felt a call to the contemplative life. She wanted to enter an order that spent much of their day adoring the Holy Eucharist. And as she had this call, this thought, one day she went to Mass, and she was, you know, thinking about her next steps and how she was going to enter this order if God wanted that. And all of a sudden she thought, But do I really understand that it's God, Jesus Christ himself in the Eucharist? Like, if I really understood that, wouldn't I just, it's like, it's hard to explain, but the way she described it, but she's like, wouldn't every part of my life be radically different? Like, wouldn't I be just prostrating myself in the aisles in front of, you know, as I went up to receive communion? Wouldn't I break these habits or change these things? And it was like an aha moment for her that, yes, she did believe Jesus was there in the Most Holy Eucharist, but she didn't really live it in her life. And I think for all of us, it would be hard to say that we truly live it in every moment of our life. That would be a great challenge, but it's what we're called to do little by little, to grow closer to that. So what are the fruits of Holy Communion? There are several in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, and I'd like to look at four of them. And then I'll tack on one extra of my own that I think the Catechism forgot to mention. No, I'm just kidding. One that I also experienced in my life. So the first one, and I think possibly the most important one, is an intimate union with Jesus Christ. And I think, of course, it doesn't get more important than this. So receiving the body and the blood of Christ into our life is uniting ourselves fully. Think of that. To receive his body into your own body, to let it run through your bloodstream, to enter into your corporal being, God himself. That is about as close as you can get. I had this really enlightening experience when my daughter was born, and I was able to breastfeed her, which was really a beautiful experience, and it brought me very close to my daughter. When I was feeding her, I felt such love for her, like a feeling of great bonding. And I realized that in a very small way, I was actually giving a little bit of my own body to her. You know, my body makes the milk, and then it gives it to my daughter. And it doesn't detract from my own body at all. It's not painful. It doesn't, like, rip away parts of my body that I miss later on or anything like that. I think maybe it's the closest physical analogy we have here on this earth to what the Eucharist is like, an experience where Christ himself truly gives his body to you, but it doesn't decrease anything from him. Rather, it increases the bond between you. It's really a beautiful moment. Pope Francis has a beautiful quote about the union with Christ in the Eucharist. He says, "The fruits of this profound union with Jesus are marvelous. Our whole being is transformed by the grace of the Holy Spirit. Soul, intelligence, will, affections, and even the body, because we are united in body and spirit." That's beautiful. And actually, I will quote just the next segment of this same quote in a minute in another fruit of the Holy Spirit. This was a talk he gave in Cuba to the youth. And so I think in my own life, truly, I mean, really, what can I do but stand up here? I'm not a theologian. I feel a little underqualified to talk about the Holy Eucharist. The only thing I can really tell you is how it has impacted my own life. And truly, it has impacted it a great deal. I think, you know, although I was lucky enough to grow up Catholic, I would definitely characterize myself as a lukewarm Catholic through college. And after college, I wasn't super interested in the faith, and I didn't know very much about it. And I really believe that what has transformed my life is the Holy Eucharist. I was lucky enough to go in Belize. The fathers there gave an hour of Holy Adoration every single day, which was like one of the best gifts I ever received in my life. And I saw this transformation in myself as I attended this Holy Hour every day. At first, I was so distracted and could barely think what I was gonna do with a whole hour of myself. Oh, if only I had like a little book I could whip out and read something nice about Jesus, that would be so great. And then as the year progressed, I was able to learn, like, Jesus taught me a little bit how to pray. And I see also how the fruits of that have gone through my own life. Part of this union with Christ, the Catechism says, is that we also grow in the Christian life. And I really think of this as almost like renewing the graces of baptism.
When we are baptized, God gives us specific gifts and talents and graces that we have inside of us. And they're fully ready, but they, like a seed in the earth, they need the right conditions to truly grow. I am, well, a very mediocre gardener. I do love to garden, but I'm not very good at it. And I will tell you from true experience that not all my seeds grow. Right now I have these stubby little peas that are just trying to do something and not really achieving anything. And so I think of, in baptism, we're given these graces and we need the right conditions to grow. So think of the Eucharist as miracle grow in this sense, I guess. literally miracle grow, yeah? You just put it on and whoa, your pea is like 2 feet tall. How did that happen? The second fruit of Holy Communion that the Catechism talks about is that it separates us from sin. And I think this is such a powerful fruit. The Catechism puts it so well. It says, it cleanses us from our past sins and prevents us from future sin. So really a double whammy here. You think of past sin, everything that you've, changed my soy on me, how sneaky. Everything in your past that you've committed, slowly the Eucharist cleanses it away. Obviously does not replace the sacrament of confession. That's really the sacrament that truly is meant to forgive sins. It is the only place that mortal sins can be forgiven. But in the Mass, and in the moment of the Kyrie, even your venial sins every day can be washed away like the rain. Or, I love this photo here, like clearing off the windshield. I think this is like Holy Communion. You know, you come in with your windshield just a little grubby from the day before, and then in the Mass it kind of gets slicked clean so you can really see Jesus. And I think the reason that God does this, I think of Mary. God wanted to give Jesus to Mary fully in her body to have Jesus in her womb. So what did he do? He prevented her from any sin at all so that she would be ready to receive Jesus. And I think in a much smaller way, God asks that we cleanse our souls of these venial sins so that we'd be ready to receive Jesus every time we receive him. He wants our windshield to be super clean. But it also prevents future sin. The Eucharist is like sunscreen. Take it and you don't get burned so easily. It gives you some protection. Maybe the word protection has kind of almost a superstitious sound to it that I don't like. But it's true. The Eucharist creates graces in your soul that really help you to choose rightly and to steer from wrong. The third fruit of Holy Communion, it increases our charity. Sometimes I just think of some of the people who are such role models to me for charity. I think of Mother Teresa and the monumental work that she did in the streets. How could she do it? Maybe it was exciting at first, but she did it for a long time. There must have come a point where she thought, the beach sounds really good, and I'm sitting here picking up another person off the street. What could give her that sort of fortitude, of perseverance? I think it has to be the Holy Eucharist. And in fact, she said frequently that that Holy Communion was her stay. It gave her the strength she needed every single day. I love this picture here because this to me really embodies what the Eucharist is to me. It's God reaching down for you, extending his hand, looking for you, just the way that he came down to the Garden of Eden and he searched for Adam and Eve. He wants to walk with you in the garden. He wants to be with you. And this is our response. We try to reach back. And we don't really, it's not like that Hollywood moment where your hand plunges up from the water and grabs the other guy's hand. I don't know if you know that Hollywood moment. No, we're just not that strong. Our hand comes up from the water and we're still 6 inches short. We're just not really able to get to God. But the great thing is that God reaches down to us. And what else is Holy Communion? God reaching down lower, stooping lower than we could have ever imagined. I doubt any think tank could have come up with the idea of Holy Communion. Nobody would have said, let's make God hide himself in bread and wine and then we'll ingest him. Like, no one would have dared to come up with that idea. It's really goes beyond the scope of human imagination in some ways. And I believe that's partly why some of our other denominations or other people struggle with this concept, because it's not a human concept at all. It's a godly concept. So here we are reaching, we try to understand, we try to be ready, and God reaches down and he connects with us. I have never seen any moment in which someone came up to communion and the host was like, nope, sorry, not really ready, come back tomorrow. It never happens. If you are there to receive communion, you receive Jesus. He is there with you every time, whether you are fully 100% prepared or not. I mean, obviously you want to do your part and, you know, not be in mortal sin and so on. But God himself will always enter you if you ask it of him. Pope Francis again, the end of that quote, he's talking about union with Jesus. And he says, let us receive a new way of being. The life of Christ becomes ours. We can think like him, act like him, see the world and things with the eyes of Jesus. Consequently, we can love our brothers and sisters, starting from the most poor and suffering, with his heart and with his heart and being in the world, fruits of kindness, of charity, and of peace. So if you remember, the fruit of Holy Communion that we're talking about is an increase in charity. So what happens when God reaches down to us? He gives us his heart. He starts to transform our human heart every time you receive communion into his heart. And the more you become the heart of Christ, the more you cannot help but reach out to other people. God asks us to do that same reach, but instead of reaching down, we reach out because we're not better than anyone else, but we are called to reach out the way that God reaches down to us. So to receive the Holy Eucharist is a challenge. We need to go forth. We need to look for others, especially those that have been forgotten, especially those that are poor. The Catechism makes a special point of this. Says, not just others, the poor, the suffering. We need to have them in our minds every day, the way that Jesus did. We need to look for them and raise them up. And not because we're better, no, because our hearts are more like Christ, we reach out in solidarity. I remember a time in which I was able to bring a coworker into the Adoration Chapel. I don't really know if this was a good idea or not. I had just discovered the Adoration Chapel at St. Mary's like 15 years ago, and I loved it so much. I hate to use this word, but I was almost addicted to going to the Adoration Chapel. I would start to drive to the store, and something would come over me, and I thought, oh, I'll just stop for a minute. Next thing I know, I'm there in the Adoration Chapel, losing time, and then I have to go home and make dinner. Don't have time to go to the store anymore. God really gave me a grace when I first discovered the Adoration Chapel. It was just like ice cream to me, that's a terrible analogy, but I couldn't stop eating it. I just had to keep going and going and seeing Jesus. I think like a honeymoon period, I guess, so much grace. And so I was young and I was had these coworkers who were used to be Christian, and I said, come with me to the Adoration Chapel, wait till you see what's there, you'll never believe it. And I tried to explain that we believed it was Jesus, so I brought them in. They were a couple that was dating, young people. And, you know, the woman sat down in the chair. It was that old Adoration Chapel and that pink chapel that was in there. She sat down in one of those enormous chairs that we had, and you could get lost in them. You could sleep for, like, all night. If you fell asleep in the middle of the night, you'd wake up in the morning in those chairs. Anyway, and she sat down, and I don't know what she was thinking, but the man, who, as far as I know, you know, he's not Catholic or anything, he fell to his knees. It was the most astonishing thing to me. He came in, he saw Jesus in the monstrance, and he knelt down and bowed his head It was like a gut response on his part to the presence of God in the Eucharist. And it just really struck me that, you know, this, how God reaches out to all people like that. Just, you never know, really. You never know when an act of charity will bring God to someone. Really, sometimes people are so ready to receive God, and they don't look it on the outside, but they are ready on the inside, and they just need that moment of connection, of reaching out. Pope Francis, one last time, he's talking to the homeless, and he says, "You, my dear brothers and sisters, you are the face of Jesus." The fourth fruit of Holy Communion. It unites us to the church. I am so lucky that I have the opportunity to go to daily mass. I used to have to work early in the mornings and I wasn't able to go and was like such a blow to me. I know I really missed being able to go to daily mass and I was so excited to quit that job and get my mornings back. And now I am so thankful I'm able to go to daily mass every morning and I take my little girl who is a singer and she loves to make noise. She's figured out that the church is very echoey and so she has little arias that she composes and sings during mass. So I have to sit in the choir. A couple times I try to be out in the congregation in the morning and it's just impossible. It's too loud. So I'm always in the cry room trying to hold off all the grubby toys and books that she's trying to give me and have some sort of paying attention to the mass. And this experience of being in the cry room has been wonderful for me because I'm in the very, very back, about as back as you can get without being in the bathrooms. And so there's Jesus up there. If I can get my binoculars, I can see him on the altar. Yeah. And I see Father, and I see every single person who comes to mass in front of me. And this experience in the last 6 months of always seeing the people in front of me adoring Christ in mass has made such an impact on how I understand the church. I really feel like the people in mass and Sunday mass too, they're my team. Like they're my battle unit. These are the people I've got around me who've got my back, who are building with me, who are fighting with me, who are walking with me. And I imagine, God willing, when I get to heaven, and there it's just like mass. There is God himself, and there I am adoring him. And what do you know? God willing, every single one of those people from mass is there too, and they're all doing the same thing. Like, I'm going to be up there in heaven, and who knows, 50 years, I hope, with all of you. We're all going to be there together in front of God, adoring God. It's just going to be the same, except no more screeching from my kid. She'll be paying attention too. It'll be great. But I'd really invite you to trust and know the people around you at Mass. I am always astonished when I meet people at Sunday Mass that I have never laid eyes on in my life. And it's not because they're new, it's because there's so many people here. So I really invite us, especially those of us who are lectors and Eucharistic ministers, we have this privilege to be able to reach out at a service to others. I invite you to know the people who are part of our team, part of our squadron. These are the people who are walking with us to heaven. Know them and invite them and support them. And especially the Eucharistic ministers. What an amazing moment to pray for the people who come out to receive communion. I think of how Jesus would have administered the communion, just praying his heart out for each person as they come up. Okay, I promised that there's one last point that's my own, and it's love for Mary. And for me personally, receiving the Holy Eucharist, as I've been so lucky to do, has increased my love for the Virgin Mary so much. And that's because when I really reflect, I think of how Mary, when she had Jesus within her, was the first person to ever have Jesus physically in her body. And she was the one who did it the most fully. Like she, at first, she was the only person in all of humankind that ever had Jesus within her. within her own body. And so I can only imagine how she must have experienced the first masses, when she was able to receive communion from the first priest, and how once again she had Jesus inside her. What an amazing moment that must have been for Mary, and how she must have taught the early Christians what it means to receive Christ into you. And you know, Mary, her whole focus is Jesus. Everything she does looks to him. And so I personally, when I realized this, that Mary had, you know, Jesus within her, I've always asked Mary to help me receive communion. When I'm going up in line and I'm thinking about the slug or whatever it is, shopping, sometimes I'll ask Mary, please, Mary, may I receive Jesus as you receive him? In that moment of the Annunciation, I bet she was not thinking about shopping. She was thinking about, I just received God himself into my being. I can't even imagine what she experienced. And so I use this moment of receiving communion to imagine and to be with Mary also in that moment. And that's really helped me to learn to love Mary a little more. All right, I'm almost done. I just want to quickly close. This is my wedding. There I am. Obviously, not this one. In case you were wondering. And that's Father Lucas. I just wanted to quickly share with you three quick ways to increase in the love of the Eucharist. And I'll just lay them out. I don't have them as the preparation. And I would dare you once a year to go past the hour that you go to sleep. So if you go to sleep at 8 p.m., go to an hour that's later than that. Or if you go to sleep at midnight, go to an hour that's later than that. Just once a year. I've never been able to pray like I do in the middle of the night. And sometimes it's like the worst prayer of my life. But sometimes it's the best. And it's really a moment to spend with Jesus. And if that's too hard, I invite you to go to the Eucharistic Adoration Chapel at other times when you can. It is like the school where you learn to love the Eucharist. The second way to grow in love of the Eucharist is spiritual communion. And this I especially invite you if you're not able to go to daily mass. Every day, God wants to come to you in Holy Communion, and you can. You don't have to go to daily mass. The saints, all the saints talk about the benefits of Holy Communion, of spiritual communion. It's very simple. There's written prayers you can find, but I just pray my own, usually. I ask the Lord to give me the Eucharist, to forgive my sins, prepare my heart, and give me the Eucharist. And then, okay, when I was a kid, I read about a saint. I don't remember who it was, sorry. But when she wasn't able to go to Mass, an angel actually flew down from heaven and like inserted the host in her mouth. So I imagine that I am that saint, not really, but. And I actually close my eyes and I imagine an angel coming and I imagine the host in my mouth and I actually swallow, like make a physical action of swallowing, because it just helps me in my mind understand that I am receiving Jesus fully. You don't have to do all that, but it's just a way that really helps me concretely feel like I'm receiving the Eucharist. The third and last point I invite you to make is to pray for others when you're in Mass. I invite you, as a Eucharistic minister, to pray for people who come up to you. If you're a lector, I invite you to pick someone that you're reading, look out, and pray for that person if you can, or if not, afterwards. And I really think that praying for others fosters a love of the Eucharist, because it helps make you more in the heart of Jesus. Thank you very much.